today we would like to present our research activities, but also research activities on the projects which we participate on different ways. Our first presenter in this block is Else Plasnik from Belgium. She comes from Aviadis company, but today she will present our activities and cooperation on MOSC-DNA project. Else, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for having me, first of all, Branka. I really appreciate that you invited me here, because it's the first time in Serbia for me. So I'm really happy to be here. I find it a very inspiring workshop, so thank you for that. So I'm very happy to present you the results we achieved through MOSC-DIN. MOSC-DIN is the acronym for mosquito dynamics. So it's slightly out of the normal topic of this workshop, but it is closely related to the activities here at the faculty, because I have been collaborating for a long time with Dusan Petric, already for more than 10 years. And so we continued working with the Petric family. Mina is now working with us, and we're very happy to have her in our company. So actually, the most of the work that I will present is Mina's work, together with Branka and myself. Let's see now. Okay, so first let's go to the bigger picture. I will go into slightly more detail tomorrow, but I feel it's necessary to already give you the global overview of why we are looking at what we call vectors of disease. And why is it also relevant for Europe. So if we look at this, these four different maps, you can see emerging infectious diseases across the globe. When I talk about vectors of disease, I'm talking about diseases that are transmitted by, for example, insects, but also arthropods like ticks. And most people think of vectors of disease or of diseases transmitted by vectors of malaria. It's the best known example, everybody knows it, and it's something you might get when you go traveling. But nobody realizes that it's also a problem in Europe, in Western Europe, Central Europe, South Europe, no matter where you are, across the globe, emerging infectious diseases are a problem. And if you look on let's see here, this map, you can see in fact that a lot of the emerging infectious diseases are also on the rise in the developed world. So it's clearly a reason for concern and a major topic of research. So as a company, and I will explain that more into detail, we come from a background of more research-oriented company towards a product-developing company, and we have always had this link with vectors of diseases. So when you want to achieve some output that will help you to understand the biology of vectors of diseases and then act upon them, you need several steps in that. So today I'm going to talk about how you could potentially forecast these, the presence of the vectors and therefore potentially the transmission of the spread. And then tomorrow I'm going to talk about the spatial aspect of it. So now we're talking about temporal aspect. So when you want to do that, you need input data. Obviously, you need to calibrate your models and you need output, hopefully. That's not different from any crop models that you have been doing. So let's first look on how we collect data, both ground truth data for mosquitoes, meteorological data, how we want to combine different sources, and then how we calibrate and get to the population dynamic models from there. So the example that I'm going to describe today is located in Egypt. It's not very, it's not a given, it's a very strange setting, but it's in the middle of the desert actually, but it's a big oasis. So actually from a mosquito point of view, this is heaven. It's a very hostile environment around the oasis, and then within the oasis you have water, so that's good for breeding, you have hosts, so that's good for food. So actually the conditions are extremely good from a mosquito point of view within the oasis. Also for us, if later on we want to talk about pest control or mosquito control, it's also a haven for us, because if we manage to reduce the population low enough, we know there won't be any incursing into this heaven. So it's an island from that perspective, which makes it a very interesting case. So when we wanted to decide where to put the traps, obviously we needed some criteria on the positioning of the traps because we want to capture the different zones within the oasis. So we've done a land cover map based on existing sources combined with meteorological factors to place our different mosquito traps. So in total we have placed 6 different traps in this oasis over a scale of about 5 to 6 kilometers in different land types. So it's all fine and dandy to put traps, but you also need somebody to be able to tell which mosquitoes you find. So one of the important aspects we did was do some training for the people in the Desert Fox Club in Bahariya in Egypt. So we had Ayman invited to our office in Belgium. This is Toby, he's a medical entomologist from Switzerland. He's now based for us in South Africa. And here you see Mina. We're having a nice lunch outside on the balcony. So it's a very friendly environment. So actually Ayman, he is a tourist guide, so he doesn't know anything about entomology. So we gave him a basic training. You can identify the mosquitoes based on the wing patterns. So that he would be able to identify which species we capture, and we get those results on a weekly basis from him. So he goes out there, he puts them in tubes like this, and then analyzes how many of each insect we find in the traps. Because it's quite a hostile and isolated environment, we also needed to work very hard on the sensors that we place there. Not only the traps, but also the sensors, the meteorological sensors that we have placed there. So we did some DIY work on the different traps. So we had to revamp them using solar panels for energy, obviously, and set them up. And the solar panels are also combined with batteries so that if for some reason the solar panels fall out, we can still get catches. The traps we use are CO2 baited traps. As a human, when you sleep, you exhale CO2 and you have some heat. So what we do is combine some dry ice originally, but then we skipped it because it was too expensive, which will mimic the heat and the CO2. So the mosquitoes are attracted to the trap because of this combination. Actually, some of these original traps are used, for example, in the US in gardens so that people inside the house have less nuisance, because the trap is more attractive than the people. So we placed those traps. We had a lot of trouble with dust coming in the traps that would block the valve for the CO2. So our CO2 bottle would be out of CO2 in 2 days, which is unheard of. So we had a lot of problems with filters and stuff and had to really open up the whole trap system. But we managed to fix everything. Well, I managed to fix everything. And we built the motor, but luckily we didn't have a lot of data loss. So we did have our weekly capture for the different species. So just looking at some of the results that Ayman identified. So overall, the species that we found the most were Culex species. Culex pipiens complex, so in normal terms, that means the mosquito that you find here. In Serbia, Culex pipiens and Culex pipiens molestus is the main mosquito you find at night in your room. It's also the one that is transmitting West Nile virus here around the Danube, so it's an important vector of diseases. In fact, in 2014 and 2015, there was a surveillance program for West Nile virus here in Serbia, in Vojvodina, I hope I say that right, region, to look at both sentinel chickens, because West Nile is a cycle that goes from mosquito to chickens to horses and sometimes to humans, but mainly circulating in wildlife, birds, chicken and domestic horses, and sometimes human cases. And it is proven that there was a lot of West Nile virus circulation here. If you want to see the latest update on the number of human cases, you can always check the European Center for Disease Prevention and Control website, because they keep weekly records of human cases of West Nile. So Culex is the majority of the catches. Some of the other catches are Aedes species. In this particular case, it's Aedes caspius, which is not a known vector of many diseases. in contrast to its let's say nieces, we call them, because it's only the females that will transmit disease, obviously. Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus, which are notoriously good competent vectors for many diseases, but that I will discuss tomorrow. But still, even if it's by between brackets only culex, there's a reason to catch them and to count them. So now we know we have the mosquito ground data. We also need meteorological data because ultimately we want to relate the mosquitoes, catches, and abundance we find to meteorological conditions. So we've set up a weather station and 5 data loggers to record the meteorological conditions across the oasis. And we have 5 hobo sensors and 1 Davis station. So the hobos are these ones here, and this is the Davis meteorological station. We also had to set up radiation shields because otherwise the measurements were not correct. And these have been transmitting, recording data for us for more than 2 years now. We need manual offload there, and then it's transmitted by IMAN to us. We are now involved in an ESA project, European Space Agency, to have a better way of offloading data, because here it's easy. We have somebody living there to do it for us. But in some remote areas, that's not an option. So we need a way of communicating either through terrestrial communication channels or through satellite communication channels when the terrestrial is not available. So we're trying to find technological solutions for that. So here we have the locations of the different meteorological stations. So for each station, we also have 1 mosquito trap. Now, because going to the stations is a lot of work, we are also comparing the meteorological ground data to either reanalyze data, and ultimately we want to go to a forecasting system. So what Mina did very thoroughly, I must say, was compare the meteorological ground data to the ERA5 reanalysis data set. ERA5 is currently the best available in terms of meteorological global data set. It's available at a spatial resolution of 30 by 30 kilometers, which is quite rough, but enough for what we have now. And what she basically did was both compare the hourly measurements from the sensors in Bajaria to hourly measurements from ERA5, and also aggregate it on a daily basis. And from that analysis, we found that if we want to use hourly data, then the root mean squared error is too high. However, if we aggregate on a daily time step, then the root mean squared error is less than 1 degree, which is perfectly acceptable for the kind of models that we want to use. So actually, this ERA5 would make our life a lot easier if we want to go to forecasting models. But we want to go one step further, because the 30 by 30 kilometer spatial resolution is still too rough for some applications. So what Mina still is planning to do is run a surface model combined with a high resolution ecoclimatic data layer with a spatial resolution up to 1 kilometer, and then force her model through it so that we would get a forecasting system. ALARO is a model, forecasting model developed by the Royal Meteorological Institute in Belgium, so that we would be able to downscale the ERA5 data to 1 kilometer. So that would give us a really solid meteorological database that would permit us to run a forecast over the next 10 days in terms of mosquito population. So let's go back to the mosquitoes themselves and how we then will bring the meteorology and the abundance data we collected on the field into something that we can predict. So this is the life cycle of a general mosquito. It's actually Culex pipiens. I can only tell because of the way the eggs are shaped. So you have the adult female, which will bite you. After the blood meal, she will develop the eggs, oviposit the eggs, and this will be deposited in water. So all these stages here are actually aquatic stages. All of them are in water. Depending on the mosquito, this could be ponds or small breeding containers or flooding areas. This would be pond. This is the pond type. So these eggs will develop into 4 different larval stages, turn into pupae, and then develop into an adult mosquito again. This cycle is quite obvious. We translated it into a sort of compartment-based model where we actually identify the same stages. So we have eggs going to larvae, pupae, emerging adults, so the ones that come out of the pupae, than the ones that are host-seeking, looking for blood, gestating the eggs, ovipositioning, and then the cycle is closed. At each step, we have eggs that die off, mortality rate, and transform from one compartment to the other. So this is already a compartment-based explanation of our mosquito population model. And then we can go to the proper mathematics of this using ordinary differential equations. Actually, it's not as hard as it looks. Basically, what it says is at every time step, every day in our case, some of the eggs will go to the next stage or die. So that's the ones that are leaving. And some will come into this stage because they the eggs are laid by the female. And so it goes from one stage to the other. All of them are linear functions except for two, the larvae and the emerging adults. Why? Because here we have a stage that is dependent on the density of the mosquitoes. So when you have a container or a pond where you have the mosquito larvae, they compete for the same resource. So when the density is too high, they will die off. The mortality will be higher than originally was planned. So this is a function that is dependent on rainfall. All the other ones are mainly dependent on temperature. So that's the link between the methodology part and the mosquito part. So what we do is either fix each of these parameters with a fixed value or have a temperature-dependent function for that. So in order to find all these values, we did a systematic literature review, which was a hell of a lot of work, I must admit, for Culex pipiens and Aedes caspius, the two species in Pajaria. So you see here some of the temperature-dependent functions and rainfall-dependent functions we have identified for each of the stages we have seen in this biological life cycle. Now it gets really technical, so don't ask too many questions about this because it's really Mina's work and it's somehow out of my league. But basically, if you want to solve these kind of ordinary differential equations, it's relatively easy if it's linear functions, but it gets more tricky when it's nonlinear. So these two are the ones that are actually making our life really hard. So what we then do is use time differencing schemes to be able to solve this in a good manner. So Mina compared all of these schemes one by one. It's amazing how she did that. And then she looked at the order of the error. So in terms of error, we are looking at an exponent. If it's higher, it's better, because always the error is lower than zero. So it would the power would make it even smaller. So that's one thing that is important. The time to compute it is also very important. And the number of time steps to get to a solution is also quite relevant. So based on this analysis, in the original source method we found, they used an Euler scheme. But if you look at the power, it's just power of one, so it's not very good. It's very fast, but the error is too high. It's simply not acceptable. So we tried to improve that. So we moved to ISODAR in the first way because the truncated error order is okay. It's not the best, but the number of time steps is quite low, and also the computational time. In the next step, we will move to this one here, VODE, but for that we need to develop our own code, while this one was available in R, so it's also a practical matter. Then she took it even one step further and looked for stability, because it's notorious when you have nonlinear functions that your model will go completely mental if some conditions are not fulfilled. So what she did was look for the eigenvalues. It's something you might remember from a long past, in, or maybe not so long past, to find the equilibrium points. And when she did that, she found that we can find a trivial solution. If all of the stages are zero, then we get a trivial solution to the problem. But only if temperature is lower than 9.8 degrees Celsius. If it's higher, then it becomes unstable, and she found a second equilibrium point when the temperature is high, but that's a non-trivial solution. We also found that when the model is forced with only temperature, constant temperature, then the equilibrium is reached at an interval inversely proportional to the temperature. If it was run but non-constant temperature, then we get the seasonal trend. And that seasonal trend is shown here. So what you see here, the green line, is the line from Egypt. So we do see an impact of season. So basically, we have a growth of population. This is the emerging adults, the ones that are going to bite you because they are looking for blood. You see a peak in summertime, and then it decreases. While temperature is maybe this favorable because it's quite warm, in the oasis, it's still a viable environment. So they do have this peak here, and then it declines in wintertime, and then it peaks the second year, and then it goes down again. We did not only do this for Bajaria, we also did the same exercise for South Africa and for Montenegro. So in Montenegro, it's for Culex pipiens. So here again, we can see a clear seasonal pattern, even more clear than in the case of Bajaria, where you have an overwintering period where the mosquito is not present due to cold temperature, and then an increase of population starting from July, peaking in August, and then maybe a second smaller peak in autumn time, and then going down again. In South Africa, we had additional problems because then the mosquitoes can go into diapause because the temperature is really too low. So then they will, the eggs will no longer hatch until the conditions are favorable again in the springtime. And that trigger is done by photoperiod. So the amount of light you get is the necessary condition. And then when once the photoperiod is enough, we can look at the temperature conditions. And then that's the moment when we will trigger the hatching of the eggs in springtime. So I would very much like any questions. I cannot stress enough Mina's work. She's a great, great person, a great, great researcher. So I cannot stress that enough. I am also very happy with the team in Egypt, in the Desert Forecast. They are very diligent and very conscious about this work. Here you can see Mina in the field in Egypt doing a lot of sensor work. And here this is Francis Schaffner. Some of you may know him. He's a good friend of Dusan. He's also a very good medical entomologist specialized in mosquitoes. All of this work was possible through financing from the Agency of Innovation and Development in Flanders as part of a funding scheme for research and development for small and medium enterprises. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Els. Comments or questions?
Yeah, one simple question. Which are the most important animals, in particular birds, as a pool?
For West Nile or for?
Whatever.
For vector-borne.
Because your presentation was related to Egypt, so let's say in the case of West Nile.
In the case of West Nile, the biggest circulation you will find in wildlife birds. And then from the wildlife birds, it will spill over to both domestic birds, chickens, and horses. And the human is actually the dead-end host, so it will not go from the human cases back to the wildlife. It will only circulate within the humans. But the wildlife birds is the main reservoir of West Nile virus.
But when you say wildlife, for example, which one?
It's migratory birds that are located in wetlands, which is, for example, the Danube Delta is an important place for West Nile.
For example, pigeons, is it?
It's not pigeons, it's migratory birds that are moving.
Migratory.
Yeah.
I am a meteorologist, and I know Mina very well, and I agree with you. She is really a great person. And we also worked with some ERA 5 data. You will later hear a presentation from my young colleague. And also we tried to debias one set of data that Mina sent us.
Yeah.
And maybe you know the result.
Yes, she's sent
it. So let's make your life more complicated. Did you try to include parameters like humidity? I don't know about mosquitoes.
Yeah.
But I know that humidity is not very relevant in any model.
Yeah. Actually, we did, but not for the Culex model, but for a model we developed for Aedes aegypti in Guadeloupe. We tried to include relative humidity because we thought that the mortality would be affected by it, especially when we have a high temperature and combined with a high relative humidity, because it influences the mortality of the adults. However, we have been working on that for several months, and the only thing that happened was that the mother turned very unstable. So it actually did not give any added value. On the contrary, it sort of messed up with the whole system, because the mortality of the adults is affected in many of the compartments, and we would have an over influence of that impact. And actually, we were very happy because relative humidity is also very variable and it's not easy to measure. So the fact that it did contribute was good news for us.
Somebody else? I would like just to add two things. Your Rubin square error of almost 1 degree for ERA 5. Actually, when Milos gave his presentation, we'll see how much it differs from for different parts of the world, for example, because it was Egypt, and this 1 degree is really huge, but for Europe, it's quite different.
Yeah.
Because as meteorologists, we know that ERA 5 and weather prediction, everything else, quite is different in respect from the modeling approach, there is a huge difference between mid-altitudes and tropics, first of all, because of measurement network.
Mm-hmm.
Because without good ground measurement, it's very difficult to produce good forecast and good ERA 5 and all other data. And in Africa, in this region, around the equator, we haven't so great ground network measurements. So this is also one of possible reasons why you have this almost 1 point degrees difference. The second stuff is that I know personally how problem we have, because we also only have data about adult mosquitoes, no data about larvae or any other stage in development, but will be really, really important for better parameterizations. And therefore, we are looking forward to applying this concept and this dynamical model in modeling some other insects which maybe have the similar pattern of development, and for which we maybe have better observations and better data during the different life stages, and the meteorology which follows these life stages, because we just have idea approximately when something starts, and then there is huge black
does it gap,
box,
yeah.
And something goes out at a certain point.
Actually, we are involved now in a project funded by the European Center for Disease Control. It's called AEDIS Risk, where we will do trials on the field in Italy, in Albania, and in Greece, where we will follow the different life stages. So, well, not all, but at least the larvae and the adults. The eggs and the pupae are usually not counted. So we will have a better idea. So we will start field work now any day in these three countries for at least until December. So we would have a better understanding of the different life stages, specifically to improve these kind of dynamic population dynamic models, with the aim then to make a tool that will permit the local governments to act and to treat against the vectors of disease, most in this case Aedes albopictus, which is a vector of chikungunya, dengue, and Zika virus. So then they will be able to assess the larvae abundance and treat at the earlier stage, because many of the products that are now available for combating against vectors of disease is focused on the adults, on the females that bite you during the day or during the night. And these are very toxic products. They are socially not acceptable anymore to use these. It's not environment friendly. There's also a huge legislation pressure on using them. So the amount of products that are still allowed reduces. And on the contrast, the problem increases. So we have to find other ways of controlling these vectors. And one of the methods is treating against the larvae with, for example, bacteria. which are put into the water, and then they will be gone after 10 days. It's very specific, so it doesn't affect other insects, and it will infect the larvae, and they will be prevented from going to pupae. But obviously, if you want to do that, you need good models like this, because if you treat too early, then the product is gone, and the larvae still go into pupae. If you're too late, well, the damage is done. They are already pupae, and they turn into adults. So then timing becomes crucial for this kind of treatments. Yes?
Well, regarding the data, did you try or did you think about the use of satellite data? Because the error you describe is relatively big.
Yes.
From the satellite data, you can...
Yes, actually, I come from a remote sensing background myself, and a lot of the spatial models that we have been producing is using, for example, Moody's Aqua Terra combination, or now we are looking at Sentinel data sources, but cloud contamination is always a problem. So not in Egypt, no, but if we want to expand it to other areas in Europe, for example, or the tropics, especially, cloud contamination is a big problem. So you can get by mosaicing and everything, I know, but actually having another data source in combination in tandem with the remote sensing data is also very sensible. But yes, we use remote sensing data too. Yeah. No more questions? Thank you.